evening, church. Good to see each one of you here this evening. We've got our young people, students meeting over in the Activity Center, and I think Ted and Risa were the ones that drove the van today, so we appreciate everybody helping out, and Josh and Megan are over there with our young people, and we're going to sing a few songs, but before we do, I wanted to give you a couple of announcements that are happening, and then when we finish singing, we want to have a time of prayer, and so we're going to give you an opportunity to lift up any particular prayer requests. Each week, we produce in the office a prayer list that we can make that available through email if you're interested in receiving that, and we also have some copies in the entryway if you want to pick up one for your prayer time, your personal prayer time. One of the requests that we want to lift up is with Mary Seabolt. They left yesterday to head to Pennsylvania to be with family, and they spent the night, and she wasn't doing well this morning, so went to the emergency room and spent the better part of the day in the emergency room, and so I think they're out of the emergency room. We have some medication, so hopefully they're able to continue on and make it without any further incidents. But we want to remember them in prayer. Remember the Seabolts, Charles and Mary. And Cromwell's had kind of an exciting time, too, when they left. And you can check on them, see how they're doing. But we've got people that have... We don't have COVID restrictions, and we're able to travel, and so we're looking forward to getting out and getting around and seeing family and seeing friends. But at our prayer time, if you'd like to come forward, we're going to invite you if you want to come forward. And we have Pastor John is here and myself, and if you'd like for us to pray for you in a particular way, we can do that, and we can lift these requests that we have before the throne of mercy. And go to God in prayer. So let's begin with a word of prayer, and we'll get started here today. Father, we thank you for bringing us together. We thank you for this place that we can gather and worship you, and in the middle of the week we can stop and focus our attention upon you. We pray that everything that we say and everything we do, we bring honor and glory to your name. We pray that this would be an encouraging time for those who are here, and as well as those who've tuned in online to watch and participate together with us. I pray that your spirit would be made evident in all that we do and all that we say, because we love you and we desire for you to have your way in this place. So come Holy Spirit, we need you. In your name we pray, amen.
Oh, deeper yet I pray. anybody remember when you first fell in love? Any hands? Any hands at all?
She can't see them, though.
I can't see, but I trust you. That love, that just, oh, just sugar and honey, and oh my, that's all you thought about all the time. Well, I found a love, and I know you have found that same love because you're here tonight, and you love the Lord, and it was His love that lifted us up out of sin and darkness and depression and just all the awful things that are in this world. And you know that if any time, and I've had to say this to myself a lot this week, I sometimes am not as happy as I am when I come to church. And so I sit and ponder and think, oh God, what would I do? What shall I do? And I tell you, sometimes I feel Him when He reaches out and takes my hand and says, but I love you. What more do you need? I love you. You're my child. You're my special child. And He says that not just to me, but to every one of us. We are His special. We were chosen. That's what this, my mind just goes nutty when I think of the millions of people in the world, and He chose me. He chose you. That makes you very, very special. So I want us to sing, Love Lifted Me. If you can, stand up and sing this as an anthem to the Father, that He loves you.
Heard my despairing
this time, and I'd ask Pastor John if he would come here to the front, and I'd like to have Stephanie also come here to the front, and we're going to anoint her with oil on behalf of Mary.
Yes.
And I wonder if anybody has any other requests that you want to make known. Anybody else have a prayer request that you want us to pray for you? You can come down here to the front. If you can kneel, you can kneel. And if you want to sit, you can sit here at the front. And Pastor John's going to anoint Stephanie. And you'd like to be anointed also. And how can we pray for you? Do have Mary Lou, how can we pray for you? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So for her daughter Stephanie.
Now we come to you in faith believing. There are a lot of folks have a lot of physical issues, spiritual issues, financial issues, but this good woman has come to pray for her daughter. And we pray, God, that you'll just touch that young woman. Help her, oh God, to know she's not alone in her trials. There's a God that loves her. Even if she doesn't know you and we don't know her, so we don't know. But you do know her, Lord. So I pray in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, that even now this prayer will be answered. And when this good lady hears the answer to this prayer, she'll say, God was in it. Yes. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
What do you want to be anointed for? Oh, Holy Father, our bodies are so frail. We were once strong. We were once able to run and to laugh and to play. But there comes a time in life when the muscles and the bones start to fail us. Comes a time, Lord, when we realize we're flesh and bone. We're not made of iron. Our will can be strong. Our faith can be like a rock. But these bodies, Lord, they need attention. And sometimes the attention they need isn't the attention of an earthly doctor. They need the great physician to come. Lay his hand upon them. Encourage them. Whisper in their ear words of encouragement so that they can know. Now as we anoint this good young lady, in the name of Father, Son, Holy Spirit, we pray that she will feel the pain leaving from her body. And let her have her faith, Lord. It says it's gone because God said so. And what God says and what God does is always for our good and for His glory. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Lord, you've heard this prayer. Stephanie didn't just begin to pray when she walked down here by the altar, Lord. She's been praying. And she's praying in behalf of somebody else. And Lord, that's a wonderful thing. You told us that we could be intercessors. You told us, Father, that we could go in your name out among those that are sick and hurting and broken. Those are living in fear and those are facing tragedy and hard places. You said we could bring them to you. You said we could be intercessors. We can lay them at your feet, even though they may not be in our presence just now. They're certainly under your watchful eye. And so this prayer request, Lord, we bring to you because we believe you know our integrity. You know our hearts. You know this individual that needs your touch. So, Lord, in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, we just ask you to pour out your spirit, your blessing. Let healing come. And let people be encouraged, Lord, not for what they see, but for what they believe. And in Christ Jesus, even now, Father, We give you all the praise, honor, and glory for these that have come. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We've got another one.
Paul Stevio on my heart.
Okay.
Father, this young lady has come in behalf of Paul Stevio. We've known Paul for years, Lord, and we love him. We love his good wife, and he's going through so much now. And sometimes, Lord, he's got to live in fear, not knowing tomorrow. Help him to understand that none of us knows tomorrow. But Lord, if we look heavenward, and we call upon the name of Jesus, and we plead our case, we're encouraged in Scripture to lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways to acknowledge God.
Yes.
We're told to fear not.
Yes.
So Lord, even though doctors don't have answers, even though the great unknown stands so large before us, Lord, we can approach you with heads bowed, hearts bent before your throne, and say, Oh God, we believe in you, Father. And because we believe in you, Father, we can pray for ourselves, and we can pray for others, and we can pray for Paul that this battle will end soon, not that he will be taken from us, but that once again he can be among us. Bless him, O God, and bless him, and bless him again. He has served you for years. Now help us, Lord, that we might see his healing. All in Jesus' precious name, Father. So in the name of Father, Son, Holy Spirit, we claim this promise. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Yes, God. Amen. Amen.
I'll start with the anointed for Sue Honstead.
Okay.
She's been going through an awful lot of problems.
That's right. Sue Honstead.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Father, Nancy has come in behalf of Susan Honstead. We know Sue and her good husband, and we love them as a church. They're part of our family. And Sue's going through some terrible times right now. We pray, Lord God, that you'll lay your hand upon her, encourage her, and help her to know, because I know she believes in you. Help her to know, Lord, that even now, prayers are going heavenward for her. Lord, as you touch her body, touch her heart, and touch her mind, and help her that her faith might be strengthened, Lord. Help her husband to stand beside her as we know he always does. The Lord, as they bow before you, and we know that they do, we thank you because you always hear. We may not hear their prayers, but they don't pray to us, Lord. So as she needs this touch right now, just now, Lord, we lay her at your feet and consecrate her to you with all of her cares, physical and whatever else she may have. Let it be done, let it be so. Because we ask it in the beautiful and the matchless name of Jesus. So in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, Lord, we give you all praise for what you have done and what you're about to do in this good family. Bless her, we pray. Amen and amen.
Yes, God. Thank you. Thank you.
Father, we're living in unusual times. And sometimes there are things that seem to overwhelm us, things, Lord, that we do our best to handle them, and then we find out they haven't been handled very well. But you tell us in Scripture, you say, cast all your cares upon Jesus, because he cares for you. Be anxious in nothing, the Bible says. Help us, Lord, to look heavenward just now for this young man. And help us, Lord, to feel the touch of the Holy Spirit. And help us be comforted in the fact that nothing can happen to us, oh God, that you don't allow. And the devil keeps trying to come. He keeps trying to find a way in. He's always at the door. But Lord, convince us just now that if we don't give him access, if we don't bow down to him, if we don't, he can't come in, because we've got the whole armor of God on us, the breastplate of righteousness, all of it, Lord, we've got it. Help us now to walk in faith and believe. Help this young man to know that those of us who are senior, those of us who are much older than him, have gone through many valleys and many mountaintops too, and we've always found that wherever we were, whatever our circumstances, our God was always there.
Yes.
And because you love this young man, Lord, I don't know him, but you knew him before he was born. You watched him as he grew. And now, Lord, you know even the end of his days. So all the things you've called him to be and to do, we lay it at your feet, believing that it's possible. Help him now to have a peace that passes understanding. And in Christ Jesus, our Savior, we anoint him, O God, in the name of Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. And in Christ Jesus, our Savior, we believe.
Yes.
We believe. Thank you, Father. Amen and amen.
God bless you. We believe in the power of prayer.
Amen.
Not because we're good, but because God is.
Amen.
And he's more than able to hear our prayers and to move among us. So we thank you for joining together. And I thank you for responding and coming and representing people. I think this is a good testimony to our congregation of how we love one another. We care for one another. We're interceding for one another. And so I think that's fantastic that we see that evidence in how we live here. So there's a ladies' luncheon Saturday. There's a sign-up sheet in the entryway. You want to make sure you sign up, and if you're not able to do that here, you can call the office, and they get you on the list for the ladies' luncheon on Saturday. Obviously, you can bring a friend. Come out as an opportunity to come and fellowship with one another, to get to know each other a little better. And then on the 19th, Saturday the 19th, there's going to be a dinner for fathers, grandfathers, great-grandfathers, and there's a sign-up list for that as well in the entryway. So we want to encourage you to take that opportunity, Father's Day weekend, to be together. And we shared with the men's prayer group last Saturday how important it is for men to be the spiritual leaders that God's called them to be. And sometimes in the church, men will kind of sit back and let the women lead or let somebody else take the lead, and they don't stand up and take the lead that God's called them to take. And as a result, we hurt as the body of Christ. And so I want us to encourage the men to be men that God's called them to be. And as we think about our students over across the way in the activity center, we want to lift them up. We want to pray for them, thinking about all the adversity that they're dealing with and what they are facing. And so we pray for Josh and Megan as they begin ministry here in this community and get to know the ropes, get to learn where people live. And so we're praying that God would bless them in their ministry there with our young people and our young adults. I'm going to ask you to take your Bibles and turn to Ephesians chapter 4. We stopped reading at verse 25. So we'll start reading verse 25 through the end. Well, we'll go down through verse 2 of chapter 5. So Ephesians 4, beginning at verse 25, we'll read down through verse 2 of chapter 5. Ephesians 4, beginning at verse 25. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. He who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for that day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Father, we thank you again for your word, how you speak to us through your word. We've come to hear from you, and so we pray that as we listen, that we would hear your voice speaking through your word. Guide us and direct us, that we might be doers of your word. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, Sunday was June the 6th, and it marked the anniversary of D-Day. And some of you are historians, and you're well aware of that, and so that wasn't anything new to you, but I really am fascinated with history, and one of the things that I'm interested in is World War II, because I had a grandfather that fought in World War II, so that's always been interesting to me. But on D-Day, 156,000 American, British, and Canadian forces landed on the beaches of Normandy, the five different beaches in Normandy, a 50-mile stretch, fortified by the German defenses there. And in less than a week, so later on June the 11th, the beaches were fully secured, and the Allies had brought in 326 troops, more than 50,000 additional vehicles, and 100,000 tons of equipment had landed in that 1 week time. So by the end of June, the Allies had seized a vital port along the way, and they had brought in 850,000 men and 150,000 vehicles, and they were poised to make their march across France and eventually into Germany. It began, though, with the beachhead, right? It began on that day, that D-Day, where they secured the landing spot, and they were able to bring in more troops along the way. Paul writes to the church here at Ephesus, and he warns them that they've got to eliminate these four vices, and they need to replace these four vices with these four virtues. And he tells them that they've got to eliminate these vices, else the devil can secure a foothold in your heart and life. And so often when the devil gets a foothold in your heart and life, he doesn't stop with just that, but he continues to bring in more reinforcements and to take further advancements. And so he tells us here, lying, uncontrolled anger, stealing, filthy talk, this stuff has got to be eliminated from our hearts, from our lives. And needs to be replaced with truthfulness, controlled anger, hard work, and edifying talk. That sounds easy enough, doesn't it? Those are all simple little things. We can all take care of those. The Bible is pretty clear about telling the truth, about lying. All liars are going to have their part in the lake of fire, according to Revelation 21. According to Psalm 15, verse 4, a God-fearing man will keep his oath, will keep his word, even when it hurts him, even when it costs him. He's going to be true to his word. Truth-telling is a big deal to God. Telling the truth is important to our God, because our God is truth. And how often do we excuse the little white lie? Say, well, that's not that big a deal, right? Everybody does it, and everybody understands, so it's no big deal. There was a program on television a few years ago, and they were offering people money if they would lie, if they would go and tell a lie to their spouse. How much money would it cost for you to go tell a lie to your spouse? And then they got into, you know, larger sums of money, and they were offering them to have an affair and all that sort of thing. Unbelievable to see people respond with the right amount of money. They were willing to do about anything. My experience has been working in churches that are pretty diverse. And in our last church in Wichita, we had a number of immigrants that were coming to America, and many of them would find themselves in the church, and they didn't intend upon being in the church and not having documents, but that's where they found themselves. And maybe they came to visit family in America, and then they just overstayed their visa, or they tried to work it out with the immigration office, and it is a quagmire to go through all of those steps, let me tell you. And it takes a lot of time and a lot of money and a lot of effort, and it's much, much easier to just forego all of that and find the way around it. And so many, I mean many, thousands upon thousands of people are doing it. Stephanie knows of one young lady from El Salvador, and we talked to her, and she worked in an attorney's office and got on the wrong side of some gangs that had threatened her and her family, and they killed her uncle, and so she got out and tried to come to the United States, came to the United States legally on a visit visa, and tried to go through the steps of what would it take to get asylum and find refuge here, and it was going to take a long process, and she decided against going through that long process because the lawyers that she was talking to were telling her that it's so difficult and highly unlikely that it'll happen for you even in your circumstances. And so she decided to take the easier route and get a false social security number and get a job and start working like so many others are doing. And I tried to counsel her as a pastor and tell her that, you know, this is not a good thing. And of course she tried to explain to me, but you don't understand. You don't understand, Pastor. You don't understand. And it's true, I probably don't understand what she's going through and what she had to deal with back in her home. I've talked to other family members that of different families that were from Nicaragua. And this man came over when he was just a young kid, illegally crossed and started working, and then got married, and then got saved, and had a couple of children. And now what do you do as a Christian when you're here illegally and you've got family here and your home is war-torn and your brother's been shot at? He's a school teacher and he got shot at and was wounded, and so do you take your family back to that? Those are difficult decisions, I know. But my concern was that when you start with a little lie and you justify it in your mind for whatever reason, it's real easy for the devil to take a foothold in your heart and in your life. And if we're not careful, that we can shipwreck our faith as a result. Our God is love, and our God is holy, but our God hates sin. And we see that God is angry with the wicked every day. God is a righteous judge, a God who displays his wrath every day, Psalm 7, verse 11. The total number of references to God's wrath exceeds 580. And so it's easy for people to think that we just serve this angry God who's just out, you know, blowing his top at every opportunity. He's going to come down hard on us. But if we understand the Father's love for us, then we can understand his wrath against sin. When we see what evil sin is and how destructive it is and how it destroys the plan that God has for us and the life that he has for us to live, James 1:19 says to be slow to become angry, right? Again, that's easier to say that than it is to put it into practice. Some of us were born with a little bit of a short fuse, and it's easy for us to light up pretty fast. We see in Scripture that Jesus was angry, and yet we know Jesus never sinned. But when we look and see those, I think there's about four times where Jesus was angry. Each of those times where Jesus was angry because people were making it difficult for others to come to God. And so that made Jesus angry. When they were building barriers to keep people from approaching God, that made him angry. And when he saw the results of sin and death, he was angry. John Wesley said, anger at sin is not evil, but we should feel only pity to the sinner. Because really there's a distinction here, and as a parent, you know, you love your children, and then you see them get involved in some destructive behavior, and you say, this is not going to be good, and you get angry with what's going on. You maybe see them hanging around the wrong people, and maybe introducing them to some drugs or alcohol or something else. And you get angry with that. You love your child, but you're angry with what's going to happen as a result of this involvement. Undoubtedly, God sees the results of sin, and he knows how destructive it is and how harmful it is to the life that he created us to live. And so God is angry with sin. But there's a big difference between us being angry, like Jesus was angry, and too often we find ourselves being, you know, maybe personally inconvenienced, and then we get angry. You know, if you're driving down the road and somebody cuts you off, oh, what are you doing? Honking the horn, and there's not much justification biblically for personal inconvenience like that, right? I remember Stephanie and I were in a parking lot, and somebody was backing out, and so I just stood there and let him back out. I couldn't get around him anyway, and I thought, well, I'll just take his spot. And as I wait for him to back out and move on, here comes somebody else. Whips right in that spot. Are you serious? You know? The temptation is to get angry over something like that, right? But that's no reason to be angry. We should be angry with the laws that allow the dismemberment of the unborn. We should be angry with child trafficking that goes on here in America. We should be angry with the injustices that we see going on around the world, with how people are enslaved and mistreated. We should be angry with that and not our parking spot. He goes on to talk about stealing. And in the Greek, he's very clear, you know, let him who is stealing, steal no more, right? To stop, put an end to it. And the Greek word is kleptos, right? You've heard kleptomaniac, right? I can't help it. I've just got this kleptomaniac disease. I just can't help it. In the office, Gloria Rivera was telling me the story about she had gone to Walmart, and the power went out while she had her cart with items in the cart. And so they were able to continue to run the cash registers and able to finish checking her out. And she got out to the car and was unloading her bags into the car, and she realized, these items that I set off over here to the side, I didn't pay for them. And so she goes back into the store to pay for them, and they, no, you can't come in here, the power's out. And she's like, I haven't paid for these, I need to pay for these. So she pleaded and got to come in and pay for them. It reminded me of when we were living in another town, and we had a water softener, and we had to buy the big bags of salt. And so when we were out of salt, that was my job to haul the salt from the store back to the house, of course. And I remember getting out to the car and and looking at my receipt, because I'm kind of a miserly kind of person, and looking at my receipt and making sure I didn't get overcharged, and I realized I got undercharged. He only charged me for 3 bags, and I had 4 bags, and so I'm not going to haul the bag back in, but I'm going to go back in and tell him, and it was only, you know, $2 or something, and the guy looking at me is like, are you serious? You're coming in here to pay for $2 item of salt? I said, listen, my integrity's not, I'm not going to give up my integrity for $2. I'm not going to go burn in hell for $2, right? Stealing, let him who is stealing steal no more. In an unethical society, and we certainly have one, it's easy to be dishonest because so many are. But Christians are to be different. We're not to be stealing, we're to be givers, not takers, right? The thief is to become the philanthropist, and we're to be the one who is generous in the way that we give. The Christian is to work hard. The opposite of stealing is someone who works hard, and works hard not so that he can retire with a comfortable living, but work hard so he can help those who are in need, who he can be generous to. And that's hard for us in America to get a grasp of that. But all you have to do is to travel to some of these other places in the world, and you can see just how filthy rich we really are. We look at the stuff that we have, and I hate moving. I really hate moving. But one of the things about moving that I hate is it reveals how much stuff I've got. And my dad, every time I see him, my mom or dad are showing me, well, look at this, you know, we found this at an antique store, we did this over here. And my dad said, more junk for you to haul out when we're dead, you know. They retired, they bought this big three-story house and old Victorian house, and just decided they were going to redo it all and you know, the wood floors and all the decor and everything, kind of bring it back to its original. And it's really a neat house, but of course you've got this big house, so you got to fill it up with stuff, right? So it's really easy to do. I do the same thing. If I've got space on my shelves, I want to get books to put on there. And then when I don't have space on my shelves, I tell Stephanie, I need to buy more barns, more bookshelves. She tells me I'm crazy. The Bible teaches that there's dignity in labor, and we do everything that we do for the glory of God. All of our work, all of our labor, whether we're mowing the grass, whether we're doing the dishes, whether we're washing the windows, everything, scrubbing the toilets, it's all for the glory of God. Verse 29 says, our talk should be used to build people up, not to tear people down. The word for unwholesome talk is rotten, rancid, like vegetables, fruit that's gone bad. Anybody that's worked on the food distribution, sometimes you run into some bad stuff there. You got to sort through that. That's no bueno. That's no fun. Not good at all. But Stephanie and I, we have this vegetable bin in our kitchen, and she'll put onions in there and potatoes in there. And you know what happens? Sometimes one or two potatoes get stuffed back in the corner, and you come in and, whoa, what stinks in here? Is it one of these dish rags? Do we need to wash the dish? No, it's not the dish rag. What's the stink coming from? And then pretty soon you discover it's a stinking, rotten potato, right? The Bible tells us that our words are like that sometimes, and how we're dishing that out, that stink, we're dishing that out to others. If someone were to listen to you and listen to your words and evaluate your words through the day, how would they classify your talk? Well, I directed it at, I was justified, right? Are you tearing people down, or are you building people up? You know, some of us get so self-centered that our conversation is just about us and consumed with us and my world and my needs and my thoughts and my life. And we can't think about edifying somebody else or how we might encourage someone else because, you know, we gather in a place like this and we walk in the doors and we're looking for the first person that I can tell my story to. Let me tell you what happened to me today. Stephanie and I, we had a conversation with a couple that I think they'd visited our church, and so we'd gone out to eat a meal with them, and you know, like 3 hours later, we get in the car, and I said, "Oh, my ears are hurting," just nonstop. And when she would take a breath, he would jump in, and we just, it's like watching a tennis match back and forth, and all you do to keep up. And they got involved in the church and got to be part of the church, and they're good people. And I remember having a conversation with them, like, you know, one of the reasons that people have a hard time getting close to you is because you just, you know, all over them with your words. You need to stop and listen every once in a while. Well, I've got nobody to listen to me at home. My husband's talking, my wife's talking, so they blame it on each other. Sometimes we get consumed with our world and our situation, our problem. We come to a place like this instead of looking around to see who might need a word of encouragement, who might need to be lifted up, who might need to be blessed with our words. We're focused on ourselves and seeing if we've got a hearing. Will you hear my story? I remember Dallas Willard, I quote him all the time, but Dallas Willard was a professor at USC, a philosophy professor, and in one of these, you know, freshman-type classes that he was teaching, undergrad class certainly that he was teaching, and he had a student that was very anti-God and anti-Christianity, and so he was coming at Dallas Willard and coming after him with argument, and at the end of the class period, Dallas just closed the class and didn't respond. And so one of the friends who was observing Dallas said, "What in the world are you doing? I mean, you could have destroyed every one of his arguments." He said, "Yeah, but I'm learning that I don't have to have the last word. And so God's working on me to teach me this discipline of not having the last word." That's hard for somebody like me. I'll be honest, that's a challenge for me. And when I was in high school, I was a debater, and so I'm always thinking about ways and how I can angle and what I'm going to respond, and sometimes I got to just bite the tongue and be quiet, and just be silent, and I don't even always have to say the last word, right? Gossip, of course. That's something I never repeat, so if you're going to talk to me after the service, you better listen closely the first time. Gossip can be true, but you don't have to say it. Are we building others up with our words? Are we encouraging others? Are we looking for opportunities to encourage others? Or are we rotten speech? Verse 27 and 30, we don't give the devil a place and we don't grieve the Holy Spirit of God. And each time that we choose to sin, we open the door for the devil to do his work and to take root and take hold and to take more ground in our heart and our life. There's an older preacher, E.E. Schellenhammer. He preached that we grieve the Holy Spirit in conversation which involves evil speaking, foolish talking, unkind words, and vain conversations. We grieve the Spirit in our employment of time. We grieve the Spirit in our mismanagement of money, either by extravagance or miserliness. We grieve the Spirit in lack of proper government in our home. Aren't you glad he's not our pastor? Ouch. Wesley cautioned, "Do not force the Holy Spirit to withdraw from you as a friend does whom you grieve by unkind behavior. create in your heart and your life a welcoming environment for God to dwell. If we grieve the Holy Spirit, we grieve our only guide to heaven, the only physician for our fallen souls, our only comforter in our troubled times. Be careful not to grieve the Holy Spirit. And here in this passage of Scripture, I think it's pretty clear that change is not just possible, but change is expected. Transformation is expected from us. It's not a matter of, well, we're all going to fall short, and that's too bad. But God's a loving God, and He's a forgiving God, and so let's move on our merry way. We see in the Scripture that we need to get rid of this old way of living, and we need to embrace this new way of living, that there's a transformation, a foundational transformation that takes place when we're born again. When we are born again, there's a real change that happens in our heart and life, and the Holy Spirit of God takes up residence within us. And then He's not done then. He wants to keep on working. He wants to sanctify us entirely, through and through. And the thing of it is, I've discovered when I stop and I say, God, where have I fallen short? It doesn't take Him very long to point out one area or another where I've fallen short. There's a hymn, Thomas Chisholm, "Oh, to be like thee." I don't know, the ladies, are you able to play that? Number 490? Maybe we could stand and close with singing 490, "Oh, to be like thee," as our closing prayer. Be imitators of God. That means we need to have a heart that seeks God and wants to be like Him.
Oh, to be like Thee, blessed Redeemer, this is my constant longing and prayer. Gladly I'll forfeit all of earth's treasure, Jesus, thy perfect likeness to wear. Oh, to be like thee, oh, to be like thee, blessed Redeemer, pure as thou art. Come in thy sweet.
thine own image deep on my heart. Oh, to be like thee. Make this our prayer as we leave this place, that we desire to be like Jesus, to be imitators of Jesus. Father, we thank you for your word that speaks to us, that speaks truth to us. I pray that as we have heard, that we would be encouraged to seek after you with all of our heart. Help us not to be satisfied. Help us not to remain content with anything less than living like Jesus. I pray that you would give us the grace, give us the power through your Holy Spirit to do what we can't do by ourselves. Only you can change a sinner's heart. Only you can empower us to walk as Jesus walked, to be kind, to be forgiving, to be loving in all that we do and say. Father, I pray for Hernando Church of the Nazarene, that we would be a church that reflects clearly Jesus in all that we do and say. Stamp your image on our hearts, we pray, in your name. And all the people said, amen. 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 You are dismissed.